Hi there! Long time no see! Yes. I moved to a new apartment, my own apartment, in a new lab, and things are a mess. At least I got a new chair.
Nope. Let's see if I can. This is my brand new gaming chair. I'm a gamer now. This is a gamer moment.
And as everything new, the house is provisory still. There's a lot of mess in here. I want to talk about one game, you know, one video that I thought, well, if we're going to record something, it's going to be about the newest game in my library and the library of my friends, you know? The game that made me and my friends play together after a long time, BattleBit. And I realized a lot of people are talking about the game, you know? Oh, how could a game be so famous with, you know, Roblox-like graphics? How can a game be making such numbers, you know, sold really well by only three guys? And the answer is really actually back to simplicity and environment. What made BattleBit great was vision and context. Did you get that? What made BattleBit great was not, you know, the graphics or the fact that whatever journalists are talking. What made BattleBit great was vision and environment. The context in which BattleBit appeared in, you know, it was the perfect storm in the world of FPS, in the world of Battlefield, you know? And in this video, I aim to explain to you what context is that, you know? I'm gonna talk a lot about the Battlefield franchise to explain to you where everything started. I'm going to talk about other video games as well, you know, Insurgency and Squad and Rising Storm, other games that try to simulate war in some way or the other, and then talk about the present and the future of BattleBit, at least for me and my friends. So, cue the intro and let's go, there's a lot to talk about. So, in case you're too young to remember the games, or you didn't care about it anyway, what is Battlefield? You know, what is the Battlefield formula? So, let me explain really simply what is Battlefield. Battlefield was really, in the end, a game about a map, usually really large, soldiers with classes, so they have specialties, and vehicles. Teams will spawn on, you know, both sides, and then they try to conquest the map, using the classes, you know, their skills, squad communication, and vehicles. The formula is super simple, and basically that's the one issue, the one point where EA DICE failed with the franchise. They forgot that Battlefield was all about, you know, simplicity. You have working physics, you have a lot of complexity with the guns and the vehicles, and in the first ones of course not, but they are a product of their time. But in the end, Battlefield was all about simplicity, a sandbox. You let people get their toys in the sandbox, they play, and then after a while they get tired, they have their life to go on, they leave, that's it. There was no campaign, there was no social media, there was no anything like that. People like to explore, and of course it's a sandbox, you know, a basics, more like a, it's not a physics sandbox, but it's a physics-based sandbox, because you have vehicles and the shots and ammunitions all behave kind of fairly similar to what they do in reality. People try to explore new strategies and new maneuvers. So this is basically the formula, simplicity. People learn this in engineering since way in the beginning of the course. KISS. Keep it simple, stupid. And apparently EA DICE forgot that. So, where did it all start, you know? Battlefield 1942. I'm gonna put some pictures and whatever in the editing here, but what you need to actually remember is, let me see here, with direction. This first box right here is the Battlefield 1942 collection. Let me show you. Look at this. This was my first experience with Battlefield, you know, Battlefield 1942, the anthology, and seriously, solid game right here with the original DVDs inside and manuals, and included Battlefield 1942, the base package. Some, you know, I had some few maps on the European theater of operations, some maps on the Pacific theater of operations, but nothing too fancy, nothing too crazy. Then they released the Road to Rome, was a expansion pack. They didn't have DLCs because, you know, internet was not that prolific at the time. And then Road to Rome included a lot of Italian scenarios. People who play War Thunder will recognize some of the vehicles and some of the maps. And then they released, you know, Battlefield 1942 Secret Weapons of World War II. And everybody who's kind of fascinated by war is fascinated about... I am fascinated by war not because people are dying or anything like that. I am all about the engineering, you know? I am crazy about engineering, and usually people get crazy about the secret weapons and all the stuff that did not make to the battlefield. And in this expansion pack, you had some really crazy stuff happening. A lot of new opportunities and features you got in the game. Battlefield 1942. This is where it all began. And single player wise, it was just you and the AI for people to practice in order to go online and actually have some quality time, you know? Because if you don't learn, there's no tutorial, nothing, and then you go multiplayer, you just be frustrated. I can tell first person this experience with DCS and IL-2, you know? Games much more complex than, you know, Battlefield 1942, but still, they have a learning curve. So the single player was basically you and the AI, and I had a lot of fun, especially in Battlefield 2. The AI was really competent. And, you know, then you go to multiplayer, find a server with a good ping, and, you know, choose a class, spawn, try to get a vehicle or go on foot and communicate with people. Unfortunately, between moves, I lost the original box for Battlefield 2, but I have something really, really cool to show you. I showed that I was actually really passionate about it. This is a magazine I bought, you know, because I didn't have internet until I was older. So this was my way of keeping informed about games. And this was the release of EGM PC Battlefield 2. Can you read this? Camera? Yes. Actually, the quality of this camera is not as bad, you know. I want to improve this, but this is great. The strategic shooter online, the definitive online strategic shooter. Review and complete the strategy of the game. This is, of course, in Brazilian Portuguese. And in this magazine, you have a complete review. And here you have a complete review of the game. You know, this is a complete guide to all the strategies and how to. This is how we did old school with new games. So I bought this super hype about Battlefield 2, you know, a Battlefield in the modern era. As I depend on DVDs, you know, I did not have internet and I could not get internet. I actually had to play what was available to me in some stores in the, you know, vicinity of my house, you know, stores near my house and sometimes in other, you know, shopping malls. So I got Battlefield 2. I skipped Battlefield Vietnam. And Battlefield Vietnam was just more of the same. You know, simple game with some really not aged well graphics. And Battlefield, I don't have the DVD with me, unfortunately, but I had a complete collection for Battlefield 2. You know, and I'm gonna read here, but basically it includes Special Forces, and then Euroforce and Armored Fury, just expansion packs. And then they released Battlefield 2142, a futuristic battlefield. So Battlefield started in what, 2002, I was 10 years old. And then it went up to 2007, with the last expansion for Battlefield 2142. But there were actually other shooters in the market. I always forget Medal of Honor because the franchise died in such a sad way. But Call of Duty was there, and I don't know why, but EA DICE and a lot of the player base saw Call of Duty as a competitor in the market. And to me, this is the beginning of the end for Battlefield franchise. They forgot that, you know, I talked about 1942, and then Vietnam, and then 2, and then 2142. The formula was the same. A nice map, they tried to balance the map, the maps were kinda symmetric. Then you had vehicles and infantry with classes, and then different classes of vehicles, of course, and then let people play. That's simple. And EA DICE forgot that simplicity what made Battlefield famous. Impartially understand that, because Battlefield was not as famous as Call of Duty. It was a niche thing for people that wanted, you know, a game with less novelty and just, you know, I want to play as a soldier or as a pilot or as a driver in an online game. But that was the time, you know, the early 2000s and late 2000s. It was the time for the great campaigns, you know, games with a lot of story and compelling story. And Call of Duty was a master at that. I haven't played any Call of Duty. Actually, I played Modern Warfare 2. I think that was the only Call of Duty. And I played partially because it's not my thing. But Battlefield franchise wanted to take, you know, a step on that direction. Try to compete like formerly with Call of Duty, and that happened in 2008. I remember this. They changed the engine from Refractor to Frostbite. They went console exclusive and a Battlefield with a campaign. That was Bad Company and was regarded as a really cool game. I honestly just watched people play, never got the chance because my only console, you can see, where? Here. PlayStation 2, the original one. So I don't have many opinions on Bad Company. Okay, quirky, funny campaign, but the change was there, the change engine. They still made Battlefield Heroes with Refactor 2, the same engine from Battlefield 2, and Battlefield Heroes were funny, you know, this kind of Team Fortress game. I liked it, but I played just a little bit. Not even 2 years later, they released Battlefield Bad Company 2, and they released Bad Company 2 Vietnam. This is the change for me that started putting Battlefield in a weird direction. It was Battlefield still, and Battlefield Bad Company 2 Vietnam was really cool, but the game started getting paying more attention to, you know, the cinematic experience. And to me, this is influenced to compete with Call of Duty. Stories that, you know, move people and, you know, have a nice plot and some great moments. And then more flashy with greater graphics for the multiplayer and trailers. Because this is the era of the internet. And this is the era of DLCs and paid promotion. They did not get with the weirder stuff yet. Because in 2011, Battlefield 3 released. And Battlefield Online and Play for Free is here, but I'm not gonna talk about that. So Battlefield 3 releases, and the release is a mess. It was the worst release in the Battlefield franchise so far, but it was a really bad release. The game was completely broken. They tried to make a lot and put a lot of stuff in a really short time. Why? Call of Duty. They're trying to synchronize with the release of Call of Duty, and that is a major mistake. The game release super broken, and well, they actually got around, and I don't remember, but in less than a year the game was playable. And of course, in the new fashion of EA DICE, they release many, many expansion packs. And back to Carcon, because they're trying to get on the nostalgia thing of Battlefield 2. Then they get Close Quarters, Armored Kill, Aftermath, and Endgame. And here start some trends that to this day I hate, because I was like a big fan of Battlefield. No, a game that let me play all different roles. Like Battlefield 1942 has submarines. That was the last time, as far as I know, that it had submarines in Battlefield. I haven't played the new ones, you know why. So, first of all, the many DLCs. They kind of separate the community, because some servers that have the DLCs, people without DLC won't be able to play. You see where this is going. And then the unlocking system. I crave dopamine. I have ADHD, really, really strong ADHD since I was really young. And what happens with ADHD, when you don't have much dopamine in your brain, some stuff triggering, you get really hooked. And for me, it's games with unlocking systems. Battlefield 4 and War Thunder are currently the games I have poured most hours on, and those are games that I really strongly loved and hated. But they have some really cool unlocking system. War Thunder, you know, I made a video about it, I'm thinking about making another, but Battlefield, you kill people, you unlock gadgets. So Battlefield, you could unlock stuff by killing enemy, making points, and this is great, this works. Battlefield 3, you know, the DLC thing, not great, and some challenges for unlocking some skins and other stuff are exclusive for the DLC, so you need to play the DLC or play the campaign to get that weapon for the multiplayer, and some, you know, unlockings needed to play some forms of multiplayer that were exclusive to the DLC, kinda sucky, but you wanna unlock stuff for your weapon, you unlock, you just play the game. So it's DLC, and that's it. Well, 2 years later, Battlefield 3, they released The Turn of the Tide. They released the game that made me realize that this franchise is going down a really dreadful path. I could see it, but the community couldn't. To me, Battlefield 4 is the point of no return that this franchise goes downhill, because it's doubling down on stuff I wanted to see it removed from the franchise. But they're trying to compete so hard with Call of Duty and gather more and more people to play the franchise and, you know, up the antics to up the earnings. And, well, you see where we are right now with the latest releases? I was right back then. But let's see what happened in Battlefield 4. And just to be clear, you know, Battlefield 3 was great, and Battlefield 4 was even greater. But Battlefield 3, at least, you only could pay to get the unlocks that you need to play to get. But there's no other predatory form of microtransaction. Battlefield 4 went beyond and tried to make the game even more accessible. And again, let me just be clear, accessibility is great in a lot of things, you know? When you try to dumb down a product or form of art to make it more accessible, to me, that is detrimental to the product itself or the form of art. So just be clear, I think the more people can get access to stuff, this is cool. But gatekeeping has a role in society, in the world, in arts and communities. Gatekeeping is important, makes sense. Some people think gatekeeping is the worst thing ever. This franchise dying is, in fact, lack of gatekeeping. Plain and simple. And that's my point of view. You can disagree, go down in the comments, just be civil. Be civilized, please, okay? But I believe they're trying to please every single type of gamer out there. And trying to get the gamers of the competitors was in the end the downfall of the franchise. Because they did not realize a lot of Call of Duty fans were Call of Duty fans because Call of Duty. You know? Not because what, you know, they wanted something from Call of Duty. They liked the game for it had, and Call of Duty always doubled down on the formula. So you could always count with the game. They had shitty releases, they have good releases. But the game never lost its identity, its vision. So, you know, we're gonna talk about BattleBits. Keeping in mind, vision. They lost vision. So, let's get back to Battlefield. So, they upped the antics with the destruction of the maps. The destruction were always a crazy and really core feature of Battlefield. You could destroy the environment. You could destroy houses, put trees down. But it came with Levolution, right? So, Battlefield 4... they made the battle pickups because they wanted to balance things, make games accessible. So now the classes that Battlefield 3 originally cut back from the many classes we had, tried to comprise and make the game simpler and more accessible, they realized that some classes were overpowered and some classes could not be countered by some other classes. And I mean, that makes sense. I hate the fact that they reduced the number of classes. Squad does a really good job on that. But at least you couldn't counter a sniper from far away, and you couldn't counter a support from close quarters. And, you know, that's how life is. But they want to make it even more accessible. So they make battle pickups, a feature that is not exclusive to Battlefield 4. Some previous forms of battle pickups existed on other Battlefields, but they were really niche. Every map in Battlefield 4 has some form of battle pickup. Should it be like an overpowered shotgun or an overpowered bazooka or whatever. So a person, you know, could counter somebody even though they lack skill. They put some gadgets in the game and you could counter a mortar with an UAV. People never used a UAV for that. So they made a mortar, another type of mortar. They made a drone. They made this and that. They forgot the Battlefield's about simplicity. And as many features tried to make the game accessible, just made it a bigger mess. You had an awful first year for Battlefield 4. Awful. The tick rate was super low, it was less than 30 or something. It was ridiculous. It took them, like, I don't even know how many years to make good tick rate servers, like 60 hertz at least. It was horrible. The netcode was horrible. They focused so much on features and flashy stuff and good trailers, they forgot the good game. They forgot to make a good, decent Battlefield. Battlefield 4, to me, was the turn of the tide. So Battlefield 4 at least was a good game for the community. Battlefield was getting known for the incoherence and the bugs and the fact that it was really frustrating to play. The game was called officially Bug Frustration 4. I was there, I remember. But at least they made a lot of content for the community to explore, and you know, the DLC stuff, they kept it. This is a hallmark of the franchise right now. They released China Rising, Second Assault, Naval Strike, Dragon's Teeth, Final Stands, Weapons Crates, Night Operation, Community Operations, and Legacy Operations. Some of those were paid, some of those were not. But they revised a lot of mess from previous Battlefield franchises, and they participated a lot in the community, put a lot of funny Easter eggs. Does it change the fact that the game sucked more than before? But hey, after some years, the game worked. But it lost a lot of this identity. There are a lot of explosion spam, there are a lot of, you know, gadget spam. Vehicles were super overpowered. It was not abnormal to see, you know, a little bird of a tank with like a KD of 65/0, because, you know, exploitable game. Then Battlefield became insane in the membrane, and they released Battlefield Hardline with, you know, which in Brazil, it holds a special place in my heart because they tried something new, although it didn't pan out like they planned to. But they paid, you know, at least in Brazil, some attention to make, you know, to spread the word about the game with, you know, people from Brazil. And Marcelo Rezende, a really famous journalist here, was the one giving voice to, you know, the marketing of the game. And it was really, really remarkable. We'll never forget that. Unfortunately, they made the translations mandatory, so I could not stop the game. You know, the protagonist for something like Roger from Ultraje Rigor, a band from Brazil, because I could not switch the language, even though my computer is in English, the operational system. So yeah, Battlefield Hardline, a really weird one. And then Battlefield decided to, you know what, we already lost our formula really bad by this point, why not make this game about social justice, or whatever was happening in Twitter in 2017. So they released Battlefield 1. Let me just be clear, we're here, okay? They got a real story about World War 1. This is not a problem. They have black or white protagonists, I don't care. They got a real story, they fluffed a little bit because it's a game. And so far so good for me. But it's a World War 1 game. And they made this game about people running around with automatic rifles and magnification scopes. That's it. I'm speechless. Seriously. They're gonna portray one of the darkest phases in human history, known for stagnation, disease, and you know, desperation. And they make it flashy. Ugh. Battlefield 1 is not a bad game. It's a reskin of 4, which was a reskin of 3. Tried to change my mind. Pro tip, you can't. But that was such a weird decision. You know, I had fun with Battlefield 1. Of course, I did not pay up the release. I learned my lesson Battlefield 4, and I played in a discount, and it was not bad. But man, this franchise was getting weird. This was super clear. Battlefield is turning for the weirder, and the fact that a game that was known for trying to depict a, you know, reality, and not try to make it fun, but you know, a game with automatic, everyone has super high rate automatic rifles with scopes? I don't know. I think having fun is important, but this was ridiculous. And they released a lot of DLCs, and then they decided to double down on social justice, but this time they went to rewrite history. Battlefield 5. Oh boy, this one is a good one. I don't even know where to begin with Battlefield 5, because all the things that I said would happen, you know. First of all, try to make World War 1 flashy and fun and cinematic. That is atrocious. At least the game was somewhat fun. The horses were kind of broken. Then the trailer for Battlefield 5, and that was the reddest flag of all. A lot of women in the battlefield in World War 2, you know, that didn't happen. No, that didn't happen. And then, you know, if they put some regiments of black folks in there, that happened, and it is in history. It is documented, although a minority in the battlefield, they were there in a really fucked up situation, actually. But they were there, and, you know, fighting for their country, so no props up to them. Stuff you didn't have in the army, where black and white Americans were fighting, and Europeans, Japanese, they were not in Europe, at least as far as I know. And, you know, amputees,
yourself with sauce. Amputee.
People with, you know, physical deficiencies, you know, they were not in the battlefield. They were a result of the battlefields, and that was, you know, and still is a really sad reality of war. But they were not fighting the war with prosthetics. That makes no sense. And EA DICE makes a trailer that would not by any means, you know, fake the fact that they lose their identity. They will not fool the OG fans of the franchise, but people would of course get super hyped. This trailer though, opposing to the previous ones, was so atrocious that a lot of people got pissed. Like, what the fuck is this? The sequences, you know, you have guns firing and you have vehicles, but you don't have proper shooting or proper flying or proper driving. Everything is super Marvel, you know, super cinematic. The trailer was a huge red flag, and people were like, why do we have like a red-headed woman and an amputee and a Japanese with a fucking katana? What the fuck is happening in the trailer? The company was so doubled down on social justice. The CEO or whoever, I don't care, made a statement that was super famous at the time. If you don't want it, don't play it. No, don't like it, get out. And people didn't. And the game sold shit. It was broken. The UI is broken. Everything was super, you know, let's try our hardest to do what kids will like, you know? Super out of touch. And didn't work. So after Battlefield 5, they were going to wait a little bit, you know, the people calmed down because they wanted to another reskin of Battlefield 3, and this time the community failed. You know, EA DICE screwed the pooch, but you know, that's their fault. Community actually voted with their wallets and did not buy that crap, and people say they tried to fix Battlefield 5, but I don't care. At this point, I was just laughing, you know, because I told the community, hey, this is a sinking boat, and people, you know, fanboys. Get out of the franchise. If you're not here for the game, why are you here? Why are you watching this trailer if you're not a fan of the game? You're a hater. You're a Call of Duty lover. Go play Call of Duty. And then include some racial slurs and all that, because, you know, Battlefield franchise. The trailer for 2042 dropped, and people were fooled by it. If you're an OG fan, you know the memes, you know the stuff that was, you know, meme to hell. Even Battlefield friends talked about, you know, stuff that were classics for the franchise. They tried to release a trailer, like, they asked ChatGPT to release a trailer about Battlefield, you know. They asked someone who doesn't know about Battlefield to search for memes and try to release a trailer. But the trailer was empty and nobody noticed. Nobody noticed the trailer had no, you know, proper Battlefield action. Even the quad bike, the people say, oh, they got a bike by their back, they're back. Go back to the trailer to see these comments. Desperate people, they're still there. I'm gonna show you. They throw a quad bike into a helicopter, and there is no C4 explosion in that. There was a staple of this community. There was a meme, and it's not in the trailer. The trailer has some, you know, mock-up stuff, and they're a tornado. Again, they try to reinvent the wheel. They try to reinvent, but the old formula was cool. Just put some more quality of life features in that, like stuff from other shooters, I'll talk in a minute. You can release Battlefield forever, people will buy. But no, social justice didn't work, you know, rewriting history didn't work, and Levolution didn't work, so what now? And 2042, the game had no soul, it was barren, and they tried their best, and failure. And then they announced Battlefield Mobile, they announced the next Battlefield will be a reinvention of the Battlefield formula. Again, DICE, EA hadn't learned, at least they know what they're doing. And it's selling, because they are keep announcing trash shit. So this was, you know, a quick revision of Battlefield history and how it went down the drain, you know? And part of the responsibility from them going down the drain, you, that kept buying their shit, even though it was shittier every interaction. Simplicity is key here. So some fans had vision, you know, they remember the good old days where Battlefield was simple but fun. So Ravenfield's a part of that. It's basically a revision of the single player mode from the early Battlefields. And you know, there's this power vacuum, you know. Battlefield start to suck so bad, other shooters try to, you know, get in there and get a, you know, a slice of the pie. So you get an Hell Let Loose and Postscriptum. One is super dead, the other is not dead yet. There is even a battalion that failed epically. I'm waiting for my refund to this very day. And I may look hostile to EA DICE and Battalion, Hell Let Loose, but in the end, I am sad for the developers and teams that put hard work on that product, but managers and people that actually manage where the franchise is going, the vision of the franchise, these people are fucking it up on purpose. They are just following what they feel is the best for, you know, shareholders and investors. In this meanwhile, I just found out about Insurgency, and I had some amazing time. I played, I think, more than Battlefield 3, but less of Battlefield 4 because I was playing alone. Serious thing, I played with some friends, and it was a magical time, you know. Sadly, you know, the people who held the rights to Insurgency decided to release another Insurgency, and I was hyped as fuck. But they focused too much on features and releasing super fast. You know where this is going. Insurgency Sandstorm. It killed my, you know, my passion for the game, because the first one is still super fun, the second one is not fun. I don't know why they messed up, but they tried to make ready for esports, they tried to make flashy as fuck. It had a lot of cool features, but it released in such a bad state, and without the single player campaign, I lost my interest, my friends as well. We did not play that much. Another game that, you know, Battlefields started to become arcades, and more, actually not even arcade, just casual as hell. Some people tried to revive the spirit from previous Battlefield, Project Reality. You know, a fan-made mod that was basically Battlefield 2 with more realism, actually. They went super hardcore on that. And Project Reality is alive and well, releasing new stuff every year. It's just like, it's like Falcon BMS of Battlefield franchise, right? A fan mod that keeps the spirit alive. Project Reality also became, like, some people from Project Reality released the squads, and there's a lot of disputes and a lot of drama. I'm not going there. I'm just gonna say this. Squad keeps releasing content, but the game runs, you know, worse and worse with every update. And even though you have more, you know, different rifles or different vehicles, the game runs so shitty right now that I uninstalled and stopped playing. And a friend of mine, that was the reason, you know, shout out to Leo. I played with him. He was the reason I played this game, because we had a lot of fun. And I played, I have a channel in Brazilian Portuguese of gameplay, and all the gameplays of Squad is with him, but the game got so shitty and run so poorly and so full of bugs, we gave up. So that, this is my only opinion with Squad. A cool idea, but way too serious. It needs a lot of interaction with people. And then I found my favorite first person shooter ever in history, Rising Storm 2 Vietnam. It nailed the spirit of early Battlefields. And of course, it comes from Red Orchestra and all that, but I haven't played those one. It was so simple, yet so effective. Unfortunately, Tripwire treated it as abandonware. It left the game half-baked. And not only that, but they released some patches years after the release that made the game even more broken. It was the broker. This was the brokest game. And sadly, it killed it. The last time I played was last year, and I just said goodbye to my good old friends. I'm not going back. I'm keeping the memories because the game is a really sad state. That and the fact that the whole Brazilian community gave up because the game was broken as fuck. There's no Brazilian servers, as far as I know. But I'm not going back because in this power vacuum, some fans 7 years ago decided EA DICE forgot what Battlefield is. And this is the point I started talking about BattleBit itself. So until now, it was just the context part of the video. Now let's talk about vision. So I'm not going to talk about the years of development of BattleBit, and I'm going to praise BattleBit because other YouTubers out there did it, and there's a link in here for a really good video about the history. I'm going to talk about how BattleBit is good and why. It's simple. It nails the vision of previous Battlefields, and it came in the perfect storm caused by Battlefield itself. We lacked a good Battlefield formula. They decided to make it not only the formula, but better. And what is not important on Battlefield? Graphics. You might screech and you know, take the L and cope or whatever, Seath, or, you know, the younglings are saying the internet, but Battlefield is never about the graphics. It's about, you know, awe. It's about how awesome stuff you're doing were. So they made a Battlefield old school, and they're making it better with more features. Like, you can build stuff like squads, you know? You have some good shooting mechanics and reloads, like not even Squad has that. No, I think Tarkov has. Game is doing what Battlefield should be doing. And unfortunately, Ravenfields and fortunately, the latest Battlefields were just be forgotten, because BattleBit is doing it amazingly by three people with passion for the idea of previous Battlefields. And these three guys, you know, watch the history video, is amazing. But those three guys listen to the community. They weekly make some live streams in the BattleBit Discord, and people just talk about bugs and they laugh about the bugs and they go and they fix it. They have a roadmap. It's really, you know, it's going slow because it's just three guys and they're doing different stuff. But BattleBit is being managed like every single game should be managed, you know, by people that play it. It's just that simple. Or at least you don't play it, you listen to the community, those who play. That's simple. It's how feedback works. BattleBit is what Battlefield fans wanted for so long. They are not going back to Battlefield 3 or 4. They are not going to try Battlefield 5 or whatever the fuck happened after Battlefield 1. They're going back to Project Reality, that is based on Battlefield 2. They are going back to Battlefield 1942, believe it or not. And now they're just coming for BattleBit because it's everything we wanted. BattleBit is the continuation of Battlefield 2. Ah, but it's a little bit fun and it looks like Roblox because graphics don't matter. I'll go even further. The fact that the game looks so simple is a blessing because friends of mine that I love, you know, from the bottom of my heart, but they don't have a really good computer. They can play smoothly, 60 frames. And a shooter really needs low latency for you to react, they can play it. I have a 3060, really amazing GPU. I can play it too. It runs well. Squad cannot run well on my 3060. Use all the 12 gigabytes of VRAM. How insane is that? How insane? I talked about the history and the context of BattleBit. Now I want to talk about the future. Because I want to talk about stuff that I think will make BattleBit become the definitive first-person shooter. The definitive. So, I list some things here. When you aim down, you know, there's this little bug. And as you go prone in a lot of surfaces, this should be fixed. And the devs are probably aware of this. I'm going to talk about stuff here since I started playing. And I don't keep up with the community a lot. So if you go into Discord, there's this huge list of stuff that the devs are aware and they're working on it. But I'm gonna just talk about my first impressions on the game since June. Some objects and some buildings and some parts are not destructible. I think that could change. In Battlefield, you could plane the fucking Battlefield. I think that's really cool. It makes the game exploity because suddenly you have no protection, but I think that should be, you know, should be experimented. I don't know. The spotting is kind of weird. And I think it could be improved, and the devs are aware, I know. The vehicle play, you know? I'm gonna be, you know, so far being editing videos and images in here, I'm gonna show what I meant trying to go in a multiplayer record that, but the collisions are weird, and it drives a little bit weird. But it drives much better than in squads, and even War Thunder. Congrats again, developers. Nicely done job. Vehicles are better than War Thunder, which is a vehicle game. I don't know, War Thunder is fucked up. So we need something that I hated on Battlefield Formula was the square maps. War Thunder does the same, you know? Square maps suck. That's it. You know, we need more rectangular, straightforward maps, and some maps do that already. Some don't. But I think having the option is great, and some square maps work fine. And we have more straightforward rectangular maps in BattleBit, in contrast to Battlefield, and it works much better. And it's proof that, again, I was right 10 years ago. But this is my redemption. This is my closure. Melee weapons, they say that they're not gonna have it. They have the hammer and pickaxe. And the bipods right now is useless. You put like a machine gun, you know, a heavy machine gun. The idea was to go prone and suppress. The game has no suppression. At least not a good suppression. You know, when you hit the guy, the aim just moves. Suppression does nothing. I don't want like a squad suppression when your aims start taking slaps. That was ridiculous. But some suppression is needed. Desperately. Machine gunner right now doesn't work. And when you got a bipod down, the game just rises as there is no bipod. So it's impossible to use a long range aim like a 3.4 times sight. Because you cannot hold the gun in the spot to suppress people. So that should be revisited desperately for the machine gunner class to work. Loadouts in main menu, people already discussed that. The spawn area is kind of fucked up. There's a part of the spawn area you cannot aim, but the enemies can hit you. Squad actually did this better. Bullets are neutralized. I talked about this in the War Thunder video. For spawn to work in a multiplayer game, there should be a section that forces your team to be overpowered, a buffer zone, the battlefield, and the opposite symmetry. The enemy will never be able to, you know, to spawn camp because you're invulnerable, but you can shoot. And then there's a buffer zone where you have some protection, but you're not invulnerable anymore. You can hide and you can, you know, hide from the enemy and not get shot, but you are, everything is working, getting shot and shooting at. And then you get into battlefield. This forces your team to never be spawn camped, but there's this buffer zone where you will stop and not advance if you're stupid, but not at the spawn. You can get out of spawn safely. The assault class is useless. People have been discussing it thoroughly and fervorously in the community. So there's that. Assault class is stupid. I don't see any reason to use it. Some automatic weapons are too laser-like, especially the submachine guns, too precise. Am I the only one who hates maps with fog and rain? I can see jack shit. Am I the only one? Please post in the comment down below. Am I the only one who hates the fog maps? Running people over is actually weird as well. I feel like it's not working. Like, can you run people over? Explosions are crossing walls. That's something I remember was kind of annoying, just like in Battlefield. I don't know if this is like a, you know, in-house joke about how Battlefield work, but it's kind of annoying when there is a lot of explosion spam in this game. Explosive-less modes would be appreciated. And again, you cannot destroy some buildings, you cannot destroy some objects, you cannot destroy supply crates. And the sandboxes are actually super hard. So I think some tweaking would be really cool. And my last thing, and to me the most important opinion on BattleBit, it needs a hardcore mode desperately. I only played Battlefield 4 on hardcore because to me you need to place a lot of shots in people. That's not fun. Now I love Rising Storm and Squads and Insurgency because one high caliber shot to the head, there's no helmet that is gonna help you. You're dead. People takes a lot of shots. I don't know. Maybe I suck. Probably I suck at shooters. If the characters are less, you know, agile, because now right now they are ninjas, no? They can jump and run super fast and change direction and just Q and E really crazily. And Squads did a superb job on making the character get tired and have inertia. This is, to me, you know, hardcore mode would be shooting someone does a lot more damage and moving has penalty. That would make this game much more interesting right now, because I got tired after some 70 hours of gameplay, maybe, because it's too arcadey right now. It's an amazing game, it's an amazing Battlefield, it's better than Battlefield was ever was, especially after 3. But a hardcore mode will make this game much more interesting, and the majority of my friends agree. That should be the greatest point. But again, the devs did an amazing job. They're passionate. They're communicating with the community a lot. The Discord is, you know, boiling at this point. And this is a lesson in contrast to DCS, IO2, Battlefield, Squads, MudRunner, Kerbal. Don't go for features, don't go for flash. But again, shareholders. So yeah, my major complaint, the smaller fixes, they are going to happen. I strongly believe, but a hardcore mode when you cannot spawn on a radio like some kind of virus, you cannot jump off of places like you're a kangaroo and you die when you get shot, that's going to be really cool. I strongly believe this game has a bright future in front of it. So I'll put a link down in the description because it's type BattleBit Remastered YouTube and YouTube sends to this gaming page the trash shit. This is the official channel. I'll put links for the Discord and YouTube and whatever. I just want to show you they have, you know, kind of this podcast that talk about the community servers and updates and features and suggestions. This is amazing. I watched some lives on Discord and they were super cool because they just reading the comments and reacting, just part of the community. This is why the development of this game is so great. And to finish this really long video about BattleBits, Battlefields, and the whole scenario of video games in the modern industry, the Discord. If you're passionate or curious, enter the Discord. Some really great folks here with really good discussion, some really weird discussion as well. But the important thing is, you have upcoming updates. You have... Look, they're implementing a lot of shit in here, right? And you have dev streams. They're streaming a lot of their game inside Discord and on YouTube. And you go into feedback, I have gaming bugs, but gaming bugs are not interesting. Suggestions. Look at this. People creating threads about things that they want. And the devs react, respond, and think about it. They're only three guys, but still, you can see they're making movements towards what people want. And they are themselves Battlefield fans, so they actually give their feedbacks, and sometimes they will agree with the community, sometimes they don't. But this is fucking amazing, you know, the community is discussing stuff. You never saw this on Battlefield. Never. And EA DICE shut down people who disagree with them. They want to please the shareholders, and that's it. So, get into the, you know, the YouTube channel, follow the developments, follow these guys up, and go play the game. The game's amazing, it needs a lot of polishing on some stuff, but for three guys that basically redid the game from scratch in a few years ago, BattleBeat is one of the only, you know, one of the few games that I have installed on my hard drive besides my flight simulators and Valheim. So this is how great it is. As older as I get, you know, more tired and tired, and I don't have all the time in the world to play all the fucking games. I end up choosing just a few. And I was really tired about the first-person shooter genre. I start playing Squad and Insurgents, all that, but BattleBeat made me go back. And cheers to the game devs, to the amazing community, especially here in Brazil. I wish the best for BattleBeat. I will be here playing and, you know, watching and giving my opinion. This is probably the only video I make on BattleBeat, but I use the BattleBeat as a context to actually talk about the other shooters, because we are in a really dark age. The great franchises died, all of them, and the games that are alive are mediocre, in my opinion, and BattleBeat is the exception. So I'm happy to see BattleBeat, you know, thrive, and I have to see the devs getting recognition. I'm gonna leave the Discord because, again, I don't have time to keep up with all the changes and all the opinions and all that. So I made this video, I'm gonna post it on the Discord for people to, you know, give their opinion, and then I'm gonna step back a little bit and just play with my friends, because I am really close to IL2 and DCS right now, and I wanted to do a lot of things in my life. I don't have enough time for everything. But amazing game, amazing news in this, you know, bleak scenario of gaming industry. And I am back to my channel. I'm back and making videos. I have a comfortable table to work and to play. And I'm organizing the rest of the apartment. And as soon as things are more organized, I will go back to making more videos. If you wanna know about flight simulators and war games in general, engineering and music, subscribe to the channel. And before you leave, please leave some opinions. I wanna share with the community my opinions on the game. I wanna discuss the game. And I'm not a big fan of staying on Discord. Comment what you think, what you disagree. Let's be civilized. Let's talk about this great thing that happened to us, BattleBeat, a blessing in the first-person genre. A sign that games will live in the indie and niche scenario of this industry that is getting darker and darker by the day. Cheers to the devs, to the community, to you watching this video, coming until the end of this really long video, and I will see you in the next one. Have a great one. Bye bye.